And welcome back to This Week on Channel 9. I'm Brian Keller.
I'm Dan Fernandez.
And we're back home in our nice studio again.
Yes, building 20.
Yeah, this is fantastic. There's still a little noise in the background, but yeah, it's really great to be home. This whole building has been remodeled recently. And we were shoved in a broom closet for the last few months. So, and
kudos to Golnaz and Larry for getting everything up and running.
That's right. This whole place was covered in dust, and they were over here, you know, dusting and all that good stuff.
So, anyway,
our top story is Visual Studio 2013 Update 1.
This is awesome.
This is awesome. Now, for those of you that have been getting the updates from Microsoft continuously for Visual Studio 2012, you're usually used to seeing new features as part of these updates, as well as bug fixes.
Mm-hmm.
There's a couple of small things here, but this update is primarily focused on bug fixes, performance enhancements, that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
All I can say is stay tuned for new features and potentially future updates where we'll be able to talk more about that.
Oh, you mean like update 2?
Oh, man. I don't know. That
now,
potentially.
We have talked that, you know, we're doing a regular cadence
of
updates.
That's true.
So the thought that if we put a number up, it's going to increment. This is not breaking news here.
I like my job, Dan. I don't want to break into disclosure jail here. Now, here's a good blog post from Heath Stewart. He's on our Visual Studio kind of core setup team. And he does point out that updating to update one might be slow. So if you go to apply the update, rest assured the team knows about it. The workaround is you can wait. So there's really no workaround here.
So let's be clear, though. This is about applying the update, not that it will be slow as a result
that's
of
a good
the
point.
Update.
Yes, install time, not runtime. So
absolutely.
The good news is the team's already aware of this, and in potentially some future update that might happen, update 2, according to Dan's speculation, then this could be fixed. So anyway, just hang tight. Make sure that you upgrade your Visual Studio maybe over the weekend or when you go home for the evening.
Awesome. So next story is the release of ASP.NET MVC 5.1, Web API 2.1, and Web Pages 3.1. So that's 5.2.3.
All right.
So a lot of different things on here, and some of these features have been in RCs, and this is kind of like another update. But just to talk through some of them: attribute routing improvements, Bootstrap support for editor templates. Enum supports in views, so you can actually get more, have a nice HTML4 for an enum to spit that out, say in an option list, like a list of states,
mm-hmm.
for example. Unobtrusive validation for min length, max length attributes, where you want something to be, you know, between 0 and 8 characters, for example. ASP.NET Web API, number of things there, global error handling, ignore route support. Attribute routing improvements also hit this as well. And then query parsing for the client library. So lots of stuff, and of course bug fixes. So a number of, you know, the community is obviously giving us bug fixes. These are going to be NuGet packages that you get as well. So definitely check those out.
Great. So I love when I sit down and I go to solve a problem and then I check out Scott Guthrie or Scott Hanselman's blog post, and they are solving the exact same problem. Windows Azure Web Jobs is this thing that we recently released into preview, and it's for that scenario where you just have something that you occasionally need to run in the cloud. For my use case, I occasionally needed to run a nightly job which would synchronize repos between CodePlex and our Visual Studio Online repository. But I'm sure everyone out there has a list of a dozen or so things that they might, you know, write their own custom web application today for or host in the IaaS VM. Now, Windows Azure Web Jobs is your replacement for writing those miscellaneous cron jobs or Windows scheduler jobs that you would have run in the past. And the beauty is it runs in the cloud on a server that you don't have to care about maintaining. So I love this. Scott Hanselman has a great post where he talks through how to get started with Windows Azure Web Jobs, and I'm sure that, you know, people out there have a dozen things that they can throw out right away.
Yeah, absolutely. Concurrency Visualizer Collection Tools and Visual Studio Code Metrics Power Tool. So the idea behind the Concurrency Visualizer Collection Tools, as you can imagine, it basically collects traces from the command line and lets you basically see that for the Concurrency Visualizer. So I'm getting data on what's going on in the Concurrency Visualizer, and I can see that. Now, code metrics, we're all familiar with, like, cyclomatic
complexity.
Complexity.
Yep. Maintainability indexes.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Those are all cool. All, you know, built as a Visual Studio customer, you're used to saying build, calculate code metrics.
Yep.
tools, and there's a couple other affordances in the product that basically allow you to do the same thing.
Yeah.
The idea here, though, is you can now have a command line.
People have
to be
been
able
asking
this.
About this for ages, especially if you want to like throw this into a build task, so you can see how your cyclomatic complexity is going up or down over time. So that's super cool that this is finally available. I can't tell you how many people have asked for that.
Yeah, I think the other really fun part would be like somebody can now take this and say, point it at TFS or CodePlex. Mm-hmm. TFS, obviously, the internal example, but CodePlex, and be like, what's the cyclomatic complexity, or how much code metrics does it take to be the top 25 or top 100 apps in CodePlex do this?
Yeah.
And actually do some very cool visualization. So homework for the readers?
I think so. I remember when Word first came out with this feature that would tell you like what grade reading level you were writing at? That was awesome. I think I just, my sentences were always really, really, really complex and convoluted, so I was always writing at like a high grade read level, which I thought was a good thing, but in hindsight, probably not so great.
No, really, I get to the point.
Yes.
Simple
you
verbs.
Do.
Yes.
You do. Exactly. You should see his text messages. They make no sense to me.
Hot.
Yes. What's this, Dan? Node.js.
So Bruno Turkley, evangelist, talking about Azure, Windows 8 together, and really a new tool called Node.js for Visual Studio. So the idea is it's using the Visual Studio shell. It's in an alpha state. I download that. I actually run it, and I get a development environment for Node.js. So he goes through like, hey, what do you need to do? You see you get IntelliSense, you see mm-hmm. you get files, what are the things that actually run? How do you set it up? And do a very simple hello world. So if you're looking to just be like, huh, what's this Node.js stuff? Mm-hmm. Take it for a test drive. Here's some great tools that you can download. And of course, the tools are free available for on CodePlex.
That's awesome. Good stuff. So this article is written by Nick Randolph. He's one of our early adopters who's been using the application Insights for Visual Studio Online for quite some time. And I love this article because he takes you through the process of how you would instrument an application to capture your Windows Phone usage data and bring that right back into Visual Studio Online so that you can start to understand how your phone users are using your features, what kind of exceptions they might be having, what kind of performance problems they might be hitting. So just really a great article that shows you one of the many ways in which you can start consuming Visual Studio Online application insights. One other thing I want to point out, a lot of people that have gone to Visual Studio Online may have seen that big blue button for signing up for application insights. If you click that, there's a waiting list today, and that's mm-hmm. deterred a lot of people. However, I would encourage you sign up for that waiting list because they are processing people within about 24 to 48 hours. So it's not like one of these things that is just going to go into the ether and we're going to forget about you. But
so
they
it's
are,
not months. I could actually get something in 24 to 48 hours?
That's not a guarantee, but I'm just saying that the rate at which we've been processing people has been very
quickly. Oh, wow. So. This is why you watch the show, to get these gems.
Absolutely. So check that out.
Love it. So Mads obviously talking about the newest release, which is 1.7. for Visual Studio 2013 Web Essentials. So there's a number of tools that Web Essentials provide for developers. We've talked about it before. It is a free download.
Number two download on the Visual Studio Gallery.
Yeah, what's number one?
I think it's the Power Tools, Productivity Power Tools.
Productivity Power Tools. Yep. Those are the two that I install all the time.
Yep.
This release has a number of things around images. So be able to create things like lossless image optimization, be able to do the classic things like convert from Base64 and back, paste images from clipboard onto VS Editor, which is awesome. Image sprites, so like I don't want to have somebody download 10 images, I'll create actual sprites based on those images. So a number of tools here for working with images. If you're doing that in your HTML files, this is a must-have tool.
Awesome. Good stuff. So this is an article by David Ebo, so pretty popular in the NuGet community, and he talks about the right way to restore NuGet packages. Now, I think
I'm doing it wrong, by the way.
I'm probably doing it wrong as well.
I
think a lot of people are still struggling with this, because he points out that most of the time you don't want to just check in the NuGet packages into your source control, whether that's a Git repo or TFVC. You want to actually build based on pulling down the latest version or a specific version of that NuGet packages. Now, I will take one exception with that, which is that for your release builds, I would say you should be archiving those somewhere so that you have those NuGet packages that you can rebuild from, even if the external dependency where you're pulling those down from, whether that's a locally hosted NuGet enterprise server or the public NuGet version, is not available. So I would say that that's one exception to kind of his rule. But
no, the thinking there is if I'm pushing to release, I need to reproduce. There's some error.
Yeah.
I want to reproduce exactly what happened in release.
Yeah, a good example of that, Boeing, big customer of ours in the Pacific Northwest. Yeah, they make airplanes. And they need to be able to archive all of their software and firmware for something like 50 years so that if there's, of course, an accident, then they can go back in time and say, oh, this is where the bug was introduced, or hey, it's not our problem, right?
That's a fascinating little gem.
Yeah, exactly. That's why you tune into the show, Dan.
That's why, to listen to you.
Which brings us to Picks of the Week.
Picks of the Week! So this is awesome. This is a daring photographer makes his Windows phone fly. I love these awesome titles that the marketing teams come up with. So the idea here is you have, you know, basically a UAV, or how do you want to...
A drone?
Drone, mm-hmm. maybe. Drone sounds like it's attacking, but...
And it is. Mine is.
mine will get yours. So it's flying. He actually put a Nokia 1020. One of the, I won't pull mine out because I don't want to show you up. But mine is also yellow.
All right.
Mine is also yellow. And took some pictures, and there was a photography contest. What could you do with the 1020? So he actually timed this train and knew the train schedule, when it was going to cross over this pass in
Did he follow the train?
Well, again, you have sort of like the thing, and he actually shows putting on a GoPro as well to get some video. But this is just a beautiful picture, if you could see it in the corner. You can obviously zoom in, and a couple on there. So it's just... awesome stuff, and the quality of pictures that you can get on Nokia. I was showing you the Captain America one.
Yeah, that was an awesome picture.
Crazy
you took.
Detail.
It's a good thing I don't have one of these. I you know, my family is city living, and I could just imagine me flying this outside my neighbor's windows and having the police called on me. So I should not have a drone. But this is super cool, especially for chasing trains.
Very cool.
My pick of the week, this is amazing. I don't even know how to sum this up other than to say you need to go check out the video. Basically, if this is real, and Reddit so far hasn't managed to prove them wrong, mm-hmm. if this is real, then in this version of Super Mario World, you can actually go into the game, and if you issue the right series of movements of Mario using the controller, then you can actually inject a memory overrun. And what they do is they actually manage to write a game of Pong and Snake inside the memory buffer and then jump into there from within the game. Now, of course, you're not going to be able to do this with yourself using the controller, but you can play it back using an emulator so that it is a repeatable process. This is mind-blowing. You have to go check out this video.
I mean, who are these people that are going in Super Mario World looking at it and be like, oh, look at that, address space, it's loading address space and not checking it, what if we injected?
That is the upside of having a high unemployment rate in this country right now, is people must spend the time doing this. But I think it's beautiful, it's really, you know, something unique. And then actually, once I started digging into this, there was actually a lot more similar stories out there. So hat tip to a friend of the show, Ed Keim, who pointed this out to me.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Thank you, and we will see you all next time.
See ya.